One more time for Mr. BJ Adams, please. One more time. Good evening and welcome again to the 8th annual Jordan Clark Diggs Sports Foundation Extravaganza. And I know Leslie greeted you guys earlier, but if you're happy and you're having a good time tonight, please, another round of applause. We got to get some energy up in the room for the athletes who are going to be coming out tonight. Now, before I'm up here to introduce the MC of the night, the Mistress of Ceremonies, and before I do, I really have to add that you guys are a great-looking crowd. You guys look good. That's right, BJ recognizes. You guys look, of all the crowds that I've seen tonight, I've seen a lot of crowds tonight. Of all the crowds I've seen tonight, you guys look the best. You guys should get together a little more often, hang out as a group. But I'm here to introduce the Mistress of Ceremonies. If we are ready, I'll do that. I know I'm looking my best tonight. I don't know about y'all, I'm looking my best. How many of y'all out there bought an outfit y'all gonna use for one night and take it to Macy's tomorrow morning? Is it me? I gotta get up early when the doors open. Is it just me? Just wanna make sure. Somebody just give me a cue if we're ready. In the back. All right. The Mistress of Ceremonies tonight, ladies and gentlemen, is one of the most prolific scorers in the history of women's basketball. She's also a featured athlete on tonight's program. She's an international pioneer in the sport of women's basketball. She's a 1976 silver medalist from the Olympic Games in Montreal that year. And she is the first African-American woman to be inducted into New York City Basketball Hall of Fame. That's right, that deserves a round of applause. The first African-American woman to be inducted into the New York City Basketball Hall of Fame. She has served as a basketball analyst and broadcaster for WNBA and NBA games. And I was told, I found out that she has the nickname of Miss World, everybody. So we are in the pleasure, in the presence of greatness. So I'm gonna introduce this room to Miss World and your Mistress of Ceremonies tonight, silver medalist from the 76 Olympic Games in Montreal, Miss Gail Marquis.
Seconds from 1980, 33 years. 33 years. So listen, if you're 35 or 32, all right, you feeling it? You feeling it? She was doing it when you wasn't even here. Candy, what is your feeling as to why no other high school athlete has come close to your record?
Wow, why no one has come close, I don't know. The shoes are better, the tracks are better, everything is so much better, so I really don't understand why they just haven't broken. I do believe it's desire. I think that you have to have a strong will and a desire to be successful and to stop at nothing. And my goals were to let nothing stop me from achieving what I wanted to be. And I wanted to be the world best. And once I accomplished that, I really did realize it was gonna last 30 some odd years. And I'm really not that old.
Candy Young, ladies and gentlemen. Candy, is she fast? She fast. Next up is Cheryl Littlejohn. For the University of Tennessee, a center in basketball. You know, this has usually been a track and field event. I'm so glad you made it, Cheryl. Bring a ball player up in here. Somebody I can look out of the eye with. Playing for the legendary Pat Summit Championship of 1987. Team captain. You know you're not gonna talk back to a team captain like that. Or 17 years coaching in Alabama, North Carolina, and Minnesota. The foundation director of her own foundation. And I'm gonna ask her, you won a historic NCAA championship under the legendary Coach Pat Summit, my teammate. Now what quote, what words did Pat Summit say to you that resonate with you today and help you to become the successful businesswoman that you are?
Well, there's two words. The most important thing is attitude is everything. Attitude is going to determine your altitude in life. And she always wanted us to have our A game, but she always said the ace. Be accountable, be committed, and have a standard for excellence.
Write it down. Write it down. You're getting this information for free. Where's the young one?
Thank you.
Where's the old one? Shoot, write that stuff down. Thank you so much. Cheryl Littlejohn, I'm a power forward, you know. Next up is Dwight Phillips. Dwight Phillips. Dwight Phillips, Arizona State University. Olympic champion, gold medal in 2004, long jump, also in 2000, six times, hit your mark right there, hit your mark right there, six times, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, world champion, and this is the one I'm jealous of. He got a beautiful smile and he's on the cover of Kellogg's Corn Flakes. Are you hungry? Are you hungry? So tell us about your most memorable jump, okay? The jump that from the minute you hit that board, you knew that was the jump.
Well, the most memorable moment for me was in 2003. I was in Birmingham, England. It was the very first world championship that I won. I won it on my very last jump, and you know, from that point on, I embarked on a career that would eventually lead me into the USA Track and Field Hall of Fame.
And he's young too. Dwight Phillips. Dwight Phillips. Next we have Edwin Roberts. Edwin Roberts from North Carolina College, now it's North Carolina Central. Olympian, 1964, 68, 72. Doing it. Don't you love that little touch of gray? You love that little touch of gray? He's still fast. The 4x400 relay. The 4x100 relay. And for your island people, he's a member of the Central American Caribbean Hall of Fame. Am I right there? He's retired from education as an educator, recently retired, and we want to ask him, what race brings you the most pride? Because the 200 meters, where it took a world record to beat you, that could have been it, or maybe it was the mile relay where it took another world record to beat you. What's most memorable for you?
I think both. The boat races was very fascinating to me, especially the 200. In the 200 meters, being representing Trinidad and Tobago, I was one of the first of the country to represent in the 200, the first to get a medal for Trinidad and Tobago in the 200 meters. So it was a great honor
to get a medal in the 200 meters running against Henry Carr and Paul Drayton. It was very fascinating. And thank you for your compliment.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure. Edwin Roberts. And here we have the youngest member of the Clark Sister Trio, Hazel Clark. Hazel Clark, University of Florida, Olympian 2000, 2004, and 2008. Hazel Clark in the 800 meters, NCAA record holder in the 800, and member of the Clark Sisters Trio, Director of Business Development and Nike Consultants. This would be a good one for you. This would be a good one for you. Are you known as Joetta and JJ, that's her brother, little sis. Now, when did you have your breakout moment? When did they start calling you by your first name, like Miss Hazel Clark? When did Miss Hazel Clark emerge?
Well, I'll tell you, I am always going to be Joetta and JJ's little sister, and I'm proud to be Joetta and JJ's little sister, but the moment when I knew I arrived was when I led my family and the nation at the Olympic Trials in our history-making sweep. I went from little sister to Olympic Trials champion. I made the Olympic final, and I ran the fastest I've ever run. I went for the gold, and when I came off that track, my sister and brother were the first two people I saw. So I was very proud to do that, and that's when I knew I had arrived. But I'm proud to be their little sister. I'll always be Peachy, so.
Hazel Clark! Olympic champion 1972, keep up with me, 96, keep up with me, 2000, no I'm not done, 2004. Did you get it all? Write it down in the 800 meters, as well as the 4x400 relay, a current, she's still current, she's still got her names in the books, I'm mad at her, current American record holder in the 800 meters, and the indoor record holder in the 500. I didn't run in that 500, I'm not sure. Proud mom of Gerald, age 6 and a half. We're gonna ask her, your husband and coach JJ also coached his sisters, your sister-in-laws. So how do you feel having your sister-in-laws as your main competition?
That's a great question, but to me, they weren't my competitors, they were family. It was always Team Clark. Joetta, it was Hazel, and it was Gerald and JJ. So I always knew if they ran fast that I was right there and I'd be running fast as well. So the only people that didn't like us were our competitors. So it's all in the family.
Oh boy, spoken like a true diplomatic champion. Look at her right on tonight. Jeremiah Clark. Legend. I like to mess with him, but I can't. We got a true American legend, Mr. Bob Beamon. A graduate of Adelphi University, sociology, gold medalist in the long jump in 1968. Olympic Games, Mexico City, you remember him for that jumping out the pit and kept right on jumping. 29 feet, 2.5 inches. He still remains the Olympic record holder. What year is this? 2013, his name is still in the book. Is it 45 years?
Wow.
I was watching him on TV, said, Daddy, I want to do that. Mr. Bob Beamon. With all the questions I want to ask you, I'm going to keep it with all the upheaval around the 1968 Olympic Games. How do you think your legendary long jump of 29.5 impacted your sport?
Well, I think you had first just mentioned that wonderful year 1968, which was probably the only time that we had the Olympics in such a late time of the year, which was October. And so every Olympics before and after were always summer July into August, but October 1968, I can vividly remember that wonderful day that I just dreamed about it for many, many years. I had prepared and put my mind to it to say that I would not be denied the opportunity to make the Olympic team, but also win the Olympic gold medal. And so as I stood up at that runway, starting to go down that runway, I felt so good. I could feel just the breeze. I could feel my heart beating, boom, boom, boom. And then suddenly I got to the board and I went up in the air. I went up over 6 feet in the air. And I noticed, I had my watch on, I noticed that it was
Play it.
And I landed. And so, I do think that 68 produced probably the greatest Olympic track and field team ever. We broke every record in the books. And it's just beautiful that I have the longest Olympic record ever in the books today.
And it's still in the books today.
Absolutely.
It's still in the books today. That's our Olympic champion there, Mr. Bob Beamon. Next coming up is one of the grand dames of the Olympic Games and one of our stellar African-American athletes, Dr. Lillian Green Chamberlain. Colorado State University, Fordham University, first African-American woman in the U.S. 400 and 800 meters in international competition. They let her run. She had to run. American record holder in the 400 and 800, named 100 most influential sports educators, and that's important, in America today. Trustee to the Women's Sports Foundation, Dr. Lillian. Smile pretty for the camera. Question for you, Dr. Lillian. You came along before sports became the prominent industry of today. What did you learn from your competitions that prepared you to become a galvanizing force in the international sports arena?
When I competed in the late 50s, the longest distance they allowed women to run was 200 meters. In fact, we ran 220 yards in the United States. When I learned that the United States was sending a team behind the Iron Curtain, I said, I'm gonna learn Russian. I learned it phonetically. Because I wanted to be able to communicate with the international athletes. We competed in Moscow, Russia, Poland, Hungary, and Greece, and I set American records every time I ran. I also graduated high school at 15. So although I was 17 on that first U.S. team, I was already a junior at Hunter College in New York.
No limits there. No limits
at
all.
So you see, we had to be fearless, self-reliant, and I always use, like, sports was the goal, but education. Sports was the pathway, but education has been the goal. In Paris, I was director of sports for 10 years, responsible for all the countries in the world where I build schools, I train teachers, I wrote curriculums for governments, I work in English, French, Spanish, Arabic, Chinese, and Russian.
And she's a champion with us today, Dr. Lillian Green Chamberlain. Our next Olympic champion, Mark Breland. I'm not even gonna upset him. Mark Breland, 1984 gold medal, welterweight. an amateur record 110-1, 5-time Golden Globe, 2-time welterweight champion. He's retired with a pro record of 35-3-1, 25 of them were knockouts. Be careful who's ever sitting on the right of him, all right? If he's at the table and he's on the right, you don't upset him. That right is still alive. I saw it. Mark, you're known for your knockouts. Golden Gold Club winner and record 24-0, 23 by knockout. Your amateur record, 110-1. You knocked him down 78 times. Professional record, 35-3, 25 of them you knocked him out. They're still helping him up. Knockouts in the 84 Olympics. You're not supposed to hit them that hard when you're on the international stage. What knockout was the most gratifying to you and why?
Well, I did have a lot of knockouts. I remember when I was 10 years old, I knocked somebody out boxing. I was 10 years old, and I was like, wow. But that wasn't the most gratifying knockout. But I would have to say, all of my knockouts were gratifying for one reason. Fight's over. And I'm a winner. Thank you.
Enough said. Mark Freeland, Olympic champion. And here's another stately one from our Olympic days, Norm Tate, North Carolina Central University. 1968 Olympics in the triple jumps. USA long jump champion, 63, 69, 70. The triple jump, when I was running around, they called it the hop, skip, and a jump. I got any witness say, anybody hop, skip, and a jump? Hop, skip, I like the sound of that. Penn relays, I know I got fans of the Penn relays. An outstanding athlete in those Penn relays as well. He's now the jumps coach at Rowan University right here in New Jersey. Norm Tate. It's on, Norm. So when you look at your jumpers of today, Norm is coaching. When you look at your jumpers of today, Norm, do you think your era of jumpers were better?
Better? I can't really say better. It's like comparing apples and oranges. But I think that the jumpers of my day compared to the jumpers of today, if we were competing on the same level playing field, our group would have been very hard to beat. I'm talking about the Bostons and the Beamans and the Tates and the Masons. Good friend of mine is here, Dwight, and Dwight was a great long jumper. So we've had great long jumpers in every era, but as a whole, I would say that the jumpers in the 60s were better. We jumped on asphalt and grass and cinders. They don't even know anything about that.
They just jumped. They just jumped. They just jumped. Thank you so much. Next up, we have Sharifa Barkfield, University of Tennessee. 1984 Olympian in the 400-meter hurdles. Medalist in the Pan American Games. Former record holder in the 400-meter hurdles at 55. She fast, she another fast one, 55.58. Currently, Sharifa is the employment specialist for Goodwill Industries of Kentucky. I'm gonna ask you, in college, you did not like to run the 400, not at all. This is what I heard. I read it in Sports Illustrated. Yet, you made the Olympics in the 400. So tell us what happened.
Well, you're right. I did not like to run the 400. And when you running for the University of Tennessee and Terry Crawford, you have no other choice than to step it up. And when you have great athletes such as Joanna Clark at University of Tennessee and running and making all these teams, I had to either get busy or die or get my scholarship taken away from me. So therefore, I got busy.
Run, baby, run. Sharifa Barksdale. Next we have Fedrick Knight. You may not know about Fedrick, but you need to. Alabama State University, JD, that's for law, University of Wisconsin Law School, competed in Rugby World Cup 2002. 2006, 2010. 2010 U.S. Rugby Player of the Decade. She don't look that old. Let her get you in a headlock. Let her get in there, y'all. It's all over. And now, I'm not done. Sister gonna go out and be on the bobsled team 2014 and 18. Bobsled, you know how we feel about the cold. Fedra, so how did you get involved in rugby? Because it's traditionally not a sport that I've seen in my community.
Not in mine either. I started playing rugby during my first year of law school. I needed a reason to stay in law school. God knows I needed a reason to stay in law school. And as the universe typically delivers right on time, I was training to try out for the Badgers basketball team. I was a baller throughout my life, and I was intercepted at a law school function by a rugby player. She invited me out. I went out, I fell in love with it, and that's all she wrote.
Well, money has got to be the shoes. Money has got to be the shoes for tonight. Well, here we got some football porn up in here. We need to get some football rolling. Raleigh McKenzie. Raleigh McKenzie, if he looks familiar, he's got an identical twin brother. There's two of them running around, just as good looking. Well, bring back the afro. Now get that Michael Jordan bald head. We want to see hair. University of Tennessee, a guard for the Washington Redskins. 1981 and 87 Super Bowl teams. Never missed a game in 16 years. Wow. Young man went to work. He went to work when people was hitting him. He went to work. Currently, he's a college scout for the Oakland Raiders. Now, Raleigh, you have an identical twin brother. I always wanted an identical twin. I could have done damage. Identical twin brother, Reggie, who is the general manager of the Oakland Raiders. So how does it feel now you're going to be working with your brother in the Raider organization?
Well, I'll tell you what. There's probably going to be a day where he has to come to me, either fire me or some polite way to tell me that my services are no longer needed.
Oh.
But I doubt that. He'll never fire the brother, I hope. But I just hope the Ravens keep it going strong, so I know if he get fired, I think
you
my brother's gonna be
bag.
Falling right behind.
You yeah, gotta go with it. If he gotta go, you help him with his bag
so
and say, I'm out of here.
I'm his biggest supporter right now.
But you're gonna do well right now. Be on the upside.
That's right.
Be on the upside. McKenzie.
Thank you.
Raleigh McKenzie. Now, the next woman I'm going to bring out here. If you have something in your lap, get it out your lap now. Clean your mouth, get a drink of water, because I'm going to make you stand. Now it is. Here she is. The one who brought us all together. The one who's brought us together for the last 8 years. Joetta Clark Diggs, our four-time Olympian, University of Tennessee. The force behind the JCDC Sports Foundation. Our four-time Olympian, business author, executive director, JD Sports Foundation, and this is the topper. This is a topic. She's being inducted into the New Jersey Hall of Fame. New Jersey Hall of Fame. Now, I did not say the Sports Hall of Fame. She's in the New Jersey Sports Hall of Fame. The ceremony will be at the halftime of the 2014 Super Bowl. I guess we better tune in.
Fire, girl, she's walking on fire. Gail Marquis. She did a fantastic job with the introduction. Thank you. Thank you all for coming out. Please have a seat, because I'm going to talk for a hot second. I am just very thankful and honored that you all are here today. I like to say that we put a lot of work into this extravaganza, and without you, it would not be successful. I'm just very thankful for the sponsors that we have here. Our student athletes that walked in today, they are the Joetta Geniuses. We'll be hearing more from them later on. They escorted all of us into the room, so put your hands together for them as well. And as I take my seat, I always like to say hello to everyone, so I will make sure I do that this year as well. Enjoy the music by BJ and the band, and also enjoy your food, and I'll make sure I see all of you shortly. Thank you.
One more time for Miss Joetta Clark Davis, the reason we're here tonight. Give it up.